Jenkins. We're talking Fantastic Five football, one of the storied programs of the North Shore, the Peabody Tanners, success over many decades. Matt, we joke that it might have been easier to choose five quarterbacks, five running backs, and five, you know, beefy guys for the Tanners, but we had to narrow it down right to five, and I think it's a pretty good list here, Matt. You know, when I say Peabody football to you, who are some of the first names that jump to mind?
Well, first for me, I think it's Steve Lomasny. I mean, he's around my age, so that's part of it. I watched him play a lot and read quite a bit about him when I was in high school and, you know, just out of high school. So he was a guy that, again, the type of player that did it on both sides. I mean, I think when you read the newspaper and you're watching the games, everyone loves to see the points and the touchdowns and the scoring and that kind of thing. And Steve certainly fit that bill as a quarterback. He was an excellent player on the offensive side. But if you really knew the game and you were watching closely, you could see how great he was defensively, you know, that hard-hitting safety. Mm-hmm. You know, you certainly didn't want to go over the middle with him sitting there.
Punishing.
Right,
yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, I mean, first I think of him, and then probably the second guy is Frank Candela, just because that speed is something that you rarely see around here. And you just see it on tape, and you couldn't even believe it. Like, this has to be a fast forward or something. How can you that fast? And, you know, the first time I actually saw him live was on the baseball field. And I've told this story before. He was on first base after drawing a walk or something, and I hadn't seen him ever run before. Someone hit a ball in the gap that maybe got into the gap. It may have been cut off. And I turned back to look, and he was already rounding third coming in to score. And I was like, this is unreal speed right here.
Yep.
And then obviously that carried over on the football field. And he was certainly someone you wouldn't mind paying the money to go watch see play live.
I mean, the punt returns, the interception returns sometimes were even better than the off-tackle runs for the flash. I mean, you know, the thing I think about when I think about Frank is, like, it was, you know, almost 20 years ago, 18 years ago, and, you know, before Twitter, before, you know, really rivals, big-time recruiting, you know, really kind of blew up the way it is now, and I can't even imagine what it would be like, you know, if a guy like that was playing around here. I mean, this is a guy that had full scholarship offer from Washington. After playing professional baseball, got picked up by you know, Pete Carroll at USC, no less an authority than them. Coming from Massachusetts, you know, to be an All-American, I mean, there aren't too many guys in the state that fit that bill. You know, maybe Johnny Thomas and Jordan Todman in the last 20 years. That's really about it. So I just can't even imagine what it would be like now. And you watch the highlight tape now, and it's still incredible to watch the flash run. I mean, it's really, like you said, how does a guy move that fast?
Yeah, it didn't seem real. And, you know, starting with Lomasny and Frank, and you brought up the recruiting, I think two stories come to mind, too. You mentioned Pete Carroll, and there's that famous story about how Pete plugged the video in at Best Buy when he was Christmas shopping, and that's how.
And we don't know if he had the volume, if he heard MC Hammer, which was the soundtrack of that tape originally. We've both watched it many times.
And on the other hand, Steve, I remember talking to Steve recently for a story in one of our series, probably, and he was talking about being a quarterback and thinking maybe he could play quarterback in college and going to a camp, maybe at BC, and they would give the numbers out based on your position, and he grabbed a number for quarterback, and he walked right on the field, and he saw some of the, you know, the Division I prospects out there throwing the ball around.
Yeah.
And he said, you know what, give me one of those defensive back numbers, and he went back out there, and of course, he was all signed and ready to go to BC before he opted for baseball, too, but, I mean, it's rare that you see those big Division I recruits. They don't come around very often in these parts, and to have two of them from the same school, pretty close in age, was pretty impressive. It just speaks to the history of Peabody football.
Absolutely.
And obviously we're young guys, relatively speaking, so we're thinking of those guys. But Matt, who are some of the older guys that we should be paying attention to?
Well, another Division I guy, Dick Fougere, who I didn't know much about going into the thing here, but went to the University of Cincinnati in 62 and chose Cincinnati over Maryland and Wake Forest and Tennessee. was, you know, captain of the North Shore All-Star team as selected by the sports editors of the day, which I believe was like the Peabody Times, the Salem News, the Lynn Item at the time must have got together and chosen their own All-Star team, and they picked Rushmore as the captain. He was the MVP of the Cincinnati Bearcats, I believe, in 65, when he was the captain of that team, and was drafted by the Patriots and courted by the Redskins of the day. But, of course, professional football then wasn't what it was now. I don't think he ever played, and ended up becoming an educator and a principal up in New Hampshire. But the thing about Fougere, you know, a friend of mine, Andy Metropolis, is a town historian, been watching Peabody football since he was a kid and has seen just about everybody. And he told me that Dick Fougere was the hardest hitter that he ever saw. And he made a highlight tape of Fougere just destroying people when he was in school. You know, it can seem like, you know, doing the tape like this here, but, you know, just as a project, as a school kid, you know, and as a teenager. But, you know, that's a pretty good word. I mean, he certainly saw Jimmy Festa play and, you know, a lot of the hard hitters over the years, and he aggregates to Dick Fougere, a tremendous one. And obviously, John Pazimas, you know, Mr. Tanner, if you will. It's hard to be talking about him last. Seems crazy, but, you know, Matt, just growing up in town, what did you used to hear about Mr. Pazimas?
You know, that's just kind of like the legendary name. I mean, it's as a kid, you can't even really grasp what it means. And it's almost like they don't exist. It's like they're almost just this, you know, superhero that was built up. And you know, someday people will probably say similar things about these other guys on the list. And, you know, maybe not Fougere, who's a little bit older anyways. But, you know, Lamazny, Frank, some days down the line, some kids might feel that there's just that legend and they didn't even exist. And that's how you sort of feel about Pazimas, because it was, you never got a chance to see him play, or maybe even not the tapes or articles, whatever it might be. So it just seems like they're these superheroes almost. Yeah. And
another baseball guy too. I mean, it's interesting. Three guys on our Peabody football list played professional baseball. And of course, Pazimas played both sports at Holy Cross, led Peabody to an 8-0-1 record at 38. And, you know, one of the things, he was one of the Salem News's greatest athletes of the 21st century when the staff here picked that series in 99. And one of his teammates at Holy Cross, who went on to play for the Bears, said that he moved like black velvet. And that's how smooth he was out there. Everything was effortless for Pazimas. And, you know, Matt, one of the things that really stood out for me, too, was the history here. We have a player from the Sieglitz era, Bill Sieglitz, when he won. We have two guys from the Art Adamopoulos era here, and two guys from when Niz was coaching. And so you sort of have each decade represented, the 40s, the 60s, the 70s, and two guys from the 90s. And I think that's a really great cross-section of what this program has been and, you know, perhaps could be again sometime in the future.
Yeah, I think that goes back to that point that you made, where we could probably pick, you know, five quarterbacks, five running backs, and have a great list for Peabody High. I mean, it would be, you know, it's something we'll probably talk about over the years now, even as, you know, more guys come into the program and stuff. But, I mean, I think that's just kind of the history. So to have all those, you know, decades represented, it kind of just speaks to the program and how great it's been over the years. And I'd like to kind of, you know, tip my cap to guys like, you know, Metropolis and these historians that put so much time into it.
Yeah, they know everything. Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's without them, you know, some of this stuff will be lost, and hopefully by us doing this, we can help carry on some of these, you know, these legends.
Some of these stories, right? Guys like Pazimas and Fougere and make people know about them. Well, that's the story on the Peabody Tanners Mount Rushmore of football. You can tweet us your selection, certainly. Stay with us. Next week, we'll get to the rest of our schools that we didn't hit this week, as we lead into the 2014 high school football season. It's Matt Williams and Matt Jenkins here with the Salem News.